This is ThinkTech Hawaii. Community matters here.
Aloha, and how you doing? Gordo the Techstar here. Welcome to another exciting and thrilling episode of Hibachi Talk. This is going to be fun today. We're going to talk about Bitcoin mining in more detail than you could possibly want, but we're going to make it so that actually you can actually understand it and not open up your own mining farm unless you got a boatload of money. Anyway, I got Andrew, the security guy, with me.
Aloha.
He's not feeling well. He's a little under the weather.
Way.
Too much time. And I got JD. J. Maurice, but I also affectionately call him JD because we go back since your first birthday. We've known you for long. You're the ultimate consummate tech guru guy that I've ever met in my entire life. Yeah. I watched you grow up through this whole industry, and we'll talk about what you've done, and we'll talk about what's happening in the Bitcoin mining space because you've been there, done that, so we're going to hear it from someone who's been there firsthand. So grab a libation, pull up a chair, sit down. We're going to talk about Bitcoin mining, past, present, and future. Life. Oh, and
Happy New Year,
everybody.
That's right.
Have a great New Year. Cheers. JD flew all the way in from Japan just to be on this show.
That's true.
True. So, hang on. Well, that still smells so good. Anyway, so JD, a little bit of background on yourself, because where'd you grow up?
I'm from Honolulu.
So you grew up in Honolulu.
And my family. You were the president of the board of the condominium that we lived in.
That's right.
So my family and you go
your grandparents.
Way back, yes. And I've been told you attended my first birthday party.
I did. I attended your first. And John Young gave you a piece of artwork. I hope you still have it.
Yeah. John Young. I got a lot of John Youngs, actually.
Yeah, that's awesome. Awesome. So that's rest his soul, was a great artist here in Hawaii.
For sure.
Your mom, a special lady too. Unfortunately, she's not. Well, she's watching down on us right now. But so.
For sure, I'm sure she is. Yeah.
Yeah. So cool guy. But you've always been in tech.
I've always been in tech. I started. I dropped out of school at 14 to work at a internet startup downtown.
And here. What was that startup?
That was called Pacific Interactive at the time, but then it was known as Systemetrics later on.
Yeah.
Wow.
So Earl Ford.
He worked for Earl. Earl told you to drop out of school.
Don't do the head shake and the eye flash.
Wow. We love Earl, but I mean, geez, 14 years.
He gave me my first job.
Were you like an intern?
I was an intern at 14 at Systemetrics.
At 14.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
At 14. You were in Pacific Business News at one time, if I recall.
Yeah, I had this crazy idea to build a whole bunch of servers in Pihana Pacific Data Center.
Which is DR Fortress
today, resurrected.
Yes. Pihana Pacific, then Equinix, then DR Fortress.
Sure.
Yeah.
So we're talking to this young man. This young man has grown up in this industry here.
Sounds like it.
True. And then I moved to Tokyo when I was 20 years old.
Yeah. And I think I had something to do with that.
Yeah? Yeah, I think you did, actually. That house party.
That house
party. Yeah.
What happened? You got even in trouble?
We had a little house party, and he got introduced to a number of ladies from Japan.
Oh, I see. So he chased some interests.
And now you speak and write Japanese fluently.
Well, I've lived in Tokyo for about 12 years.
Okay.
And I had a lot of time to pick it up. And also been on the countryside recently, so.
Yeah, and when you moved there, you just fell in love with the culture,
Yeah, I mean, Tokyo is such a great city. You know, it's like the biggest metropolitan area in the whole world, and they have everything. They have huge companies and international business, everything, the culture, everything, the language. Everyone's so polite like Hawaii, but it's on a much larger scale.
Yeah, I've always felt when you moved there that was going to be your spot. And so, I met your fiance the other day there. Lovely young lady. So that's congratulations on that. So tremendous future ahead of you. And you're still so young.
Yeah.
So, and you were actually, when I became the director of IT for the city and county of Honolulu at the swearing in ceremony.
I remember that.
JD showed up.
Right.
And he was there.
Of course, I was there. He couldn't believe you actually made it.
He couldn't either. He wasn't sure if he was really seeing what was going on.
Nice.
But he was, I have a picture of him and the Mufi and the whole gang.
That's right.
So
that's right.
It's great to have you there. So let's kind of jump now into the tech side. So, yeah, you've been in tech, you built server farms. So what did you do in Japan? But we're going to keep that short because I want to talk about Bitcoin mining.
So when I first got to Tokyo, I opened up my little consulting office and I had some consulting customers in Hawaii, but I didn't really know the Japanese language or the culture. I wasn't connected to anyone. And so I got a job at a Norwegian software company called Opera Software.
Oh, very famous.
Yeah, making web browsers, yep. And I worked with all their Japanese customers. So every Japanese TV, we worked with like Nintendo Wii, Panasonic Blu-ray players, all these random Japanese devices, we would make the web browsers.
Okay. You wrote the Opera software that was the web browsers for all of those.
Yeah, they made the browser in Norway, and we would port it to their, you know, proprietary cheap CPUs.
Oh, their chip, okay.
Yeah, and we would deliver the browser to their customers in Japan, and did that for a few years.
Okay, so you did that for a few years, and let's fast forward. And when did you first start getting involved in Bitcoin and cryptocurrency?
I guess about 5 or 6 years ago. During the Mt. Gox days.
Mt. Gox was the first
big one, right?
They went belly up.
Yeah.
Yeah. I got my first Bitcoin at about $8, but I didn't get into it more serious until...
$8.
Yeah.
It's $15,000 and change right now. Anyway, go $8.
Yeah. So I started getting into more serious when it was around $100. Me and a few friends, at the time, Mt. Gox was, they had some issues to say the least. And you couldn't withdraw... you couldn't deposit money to them very quickly for a number of reasons unless you had a Japanese bank account because they were based in Tokyo.
Okay.
So I was able to get funds into Mt. Gox very quickly, purchase Bitcoins, and basically do some arbitrage trading. This is when Bitcoin was around $100.
Yeah.
And we kept doing that a few times. We would make 10, 20, 30% a week just doing arbitrage.
Wow.
Until the music stopped and Mt. Gox just kind of shut down.
Went belly up.
Yeah, so everyone...
what happened to Bitcoin? What did it drop to?
I mean, it spiked up to about $1,200. Mm-hmm. That was the peak of that bubble. And then when Mt. Gox crashed, it just crashed all the way back down to a couple hundred bucks.
Like pennies? Oh, it was a couple hundred bucks. Okay, yeah, so it wasn't dead, but...
Right, but all of our Bitcoins were in Mt. Gox. Yeah, that was the problem.
And the problem is they couldn't get them out.
Yeah.
Well, they were already gone.
Yeah.
It's not like there's not an FI.
They had taken them away.
Yeah,
they were
no insurance behind the... Behind the Bitcoin.
It didn't help solidify that as a particular form of fiat-like currency.
And also, there was in the broader industry, there was a lot of illicit things going on at Mt. Gox that they were selling, right? So everybody thought, well, that's what that's all about, like, you know, the broader.
Yeah, those days
people
of Bitcoin,
that didn't know.
Spice Road and all those days are gone.
Yeah. Right, Silk Road, yeah.
Silk Road.
Well, I think the darknet markets are stronger than ever, actually. Mm-hmm. You know, because if you shut down Silk Road, then 20 or 30 other will open
up. Smaller ones have showed up.
Yeah, and I think that market is probably doing just bigger.
I'd say it's doing fine in ransomware.
It is in that space. So then when did you get... when did you get into the mine? Because you were an early miner of Bitcoin.
Oh.
Was it? No, Ethereum.
Well, I started just as a hobby with Bitcoin.
Okay.
And the first serious mining farm I did was Ethereum.
Ethereum. So we have a picture. I'm going to show you a picture of you and your mining farm when you were mining Ethereum. That will be one of the first ones. So there you are. And where is that?
So I built this farm in Compton, Los Angeles.
Oh, another high district area.
Yeah, we leased the dirtiest warehouse we could find, but it had a lot of electrical capacity.
Okay.
And me and a bunch of guys, we built about 100 or so GPU mining rigs.
Okay.
And it was really cool because with this farm, we kind of started Ethereum Classic. When Ethereum...
Okay.
Yeah, there was a smart contract called the DAO.
Right.
This is about a year or so ago. The DAO got hacked, and Ethereum wanted to change the entire consensus rules of the system to basically refund the investors in the DAO.
Okay.
And
this is not the DAO, as in the
DAO. DAO, right?
Yeah, DAO. Yeah.
And I said that goes against everything that cryptocurrencies were invented to, you know, fix. You can't reverse transactions in cryptocurrency. You can't just do a chargeback. You might as well just run a bank if you're going to do a chargeback,
right?
Or do a bailout. So I set all my miners to mine on the old consensus rules, which said that, you can't reverse the DAO transactions. And that blockchain became known as Ethereum Classic.
Okay.
So for a brief time, for about 3 days, I was the only mining farm mining Ethereum Classic. So I mined about 26,000 Ethereum Classic in 3 days. Wow. And then the first exchange, Poloniex, started trading at like $1, $2 each.
Right.
Now I think it's about $35.
Yeah, it's about $35 for that. So you did this, but what happened to that, without going into too much detail, what happened to that mining farm, that Ethereum mining farm?
Well, let's just say we had some internal disputes. And attorneys were involved.
Okay, and we'll leave it at that.
We'll leave it at that.
So that was your first
venture into this. So you got to know it and understand it.
That was the first serious mining farm. I made a lot of mistakes, some with people, some with technology, some with trading, but I learned the industry.
That's right. And you learn by trial and error, not by trial and rate. And your entire life has been a trial and
I heard you say GPU, so we're using like NVIDIA. So were you, because they were early into GPU, and GPU's huge now with the new Titan and all that stuff. So
yeah, they actually make GPUs specialized for mining right now. But
okay. We
were using totally off-the-shelf parts,
yeah.
And it was just a mining rig is basically a computer with several power supplies and lots of GPUs just running this mining software. And you just build a lot of these, and you put them in a warehouse, and you put lots of electricity into it, and you overclock everything with custom BIOS ROM hacks, and
crank it up. Huh?
Yeah, sometimes fires break out.
I've heard about that. So, and the largest miners right now, so we'll go back to Bitcoin from a Bitcoin perspective. The Linus miners are where? Because we hear about a bunch of places.
Yeah, the Bitcoin mining is all centralized in China right now.
Okay.
Actually, one big mining company called Bitmain, they make these ant miners. They control the majority of the hash power in Bitcoin right now. And they mine almost half of the Bitcoins right now.
Wow.
And they're located in China.
Yes.
Now, what about, I heard there's Bitcoin farms in Iceland.
Yeah, there's many farms there because they have geothermal power.
Okay.
And it's very cold there, and so it makes sense to get cheap electricity and good cooling. There's a lot of space there. It's a good place to do it. That's how I originally started thinking about how to do mining is to get the electricity really low,
yep.
and the cooling and everything. And then I realized that if your strategy and business sense with mining is correct. Actually, the electrical bill can be, an insignificant part of the business.
Okay, so cool. So we're actually, believe it or not, we're coming up on the break.
Sure.
And then what we're doing is we're going to come back and we'll talk about how much money you can make in Bitcoin money or not. And then what you're doing going forward in this, because you're starting a whole new project in this space.
That's true, I am.
That's going to be awesome.
Awesome.
And Angus has a sign he found during Christmas.
He wants to
show it to everybody,
right,
so we'll do that.
We'll
anyway, Gordo the Techstar here, Andrew the Security Eye, Jay Maurice the Wiz is here. We're talking about cryptocurrencies, Bitcoin, and the next wave of our lives. See you in a minute.
This is ThinkTech Hawaii, raising public awareness.
Match day is no ordinary day. The pitch, hallowed ground for players and supporters alike. Excitement builds. Game plans are made with responsibility in mind. Celebrations are underway. Ready for kickoff, MLS clubs and our supporters rise to the challenge. We make responsible decisions while we cheer on our heroes and toast their success. Elevate your match day experience. If you drink, never drive.
Aloha. My name is Mark Shklov. I am the host of ThinkTech Hawaii's Law Across the Sea. Law Across the Sea comes on every other Monday at 11 a.m. Please join us. I like to bring in guests that talk about all types of things that come across the sea to Hawaii. Not just law, love, people, ideas, history. Please join us for Law Across the Sea.
Hey everybody, aloha. Welcome back to ThinkTech Studios. This is Hibachi Talk. We're talking Bitcoin, we're talking cryptocurrency, we're talking mining, and right now we're talking to Angus. Angus, what's up, buddy?
How you doing, Andrew?
Good, brother.
That's awesome. You know, great. I got to leave that Bitcoins in my pocket, you know.
You do?
Yeah, I'm not going to.
Well, where'd you get them?
Hey, I stole them from Gordon. I did do the Mount Cox
thing. He gave me some. I didn't have to steal them.
Yeah, you still got them. You make sure you return it to me.
You think I got
to
give him a little back.
I get it. JD, nice to see you there, lad.
It's nice to meet
you. You like my brother.
You know. It's one thing to watch you on TV. It's another thing to be right next, right next to you.
The famous guy.
You meet you.
You feel the heat.
To meet me in personless. It's great. Anyway, it's Christmas has passed. But the other day there I was walking around during Christmas, and we always have a co-host, Mr. Rick Trejo, our Hispanic co-host, and I found this for him. So show you a wee sign on this thing. It's for lease. Navidad. I love people who have intuition and do all this great stuff.
That's a nice interpretation.
Good job. It's New Year coming up, and we, Hogmanay, as we call it in Scotland. See, don't get black coalty on Hogman A, so you know, make sure you enjoy it. So, as I say at the end of your segment, let your wing gang free, where A, you B, aloha, give me some more Bitcoin.
Wow, thanks, Angus, for that. Or lease, Navidad, did you get that? That's pretty sweet. So let's get into some deeper tech. Tell me, I want to know about the future, so I know where to put my money.
So you obviously built the Ethereum mining farm in anticipation of making some good money.
We did.
And okay, glad to hear that. This is supposed to happen. And then, so now you're getting back into this, but why would you get back into it when you've got like the big players like China and those players and such like that?
There's, you know, Bitcoin is so huge, there's plenty of room even for small fish.
Okay.
You know, I'm kind of moving into Bitcoin mining now.
Okay.
And, you know, we place orders for hundreds of ASIC mining rigs. These are very different from the GPU mining rigs that I had.
Oh, these are the new ones.
Well, Bitcoin has been only ASIC mined for a long time now, but the newest ASIC miners, you know, I'm placing order for a few hundred, and they say the smallest order they have after me is, you know, in the thousands of mining rigs. So it's, we're a very small fish, but it's still big for us, you know. It's still huge.
Yeah, I wish I had a picture of a mining rig, because, well, you had a photo, but unfortunately it didn't convert across. But essentially it looks like a generator.
You know, it's,
with a computer on it.
It's a bunch of custom ASIC chips that do nothing but mine Bitcoin.
Mm-hmm.
And they're just attached to this big heat sink with a bunch of big fans, and it blows a ton of air through it, uses a ton of electricity. And we put them all into this small warehouse. And, you know, we connect a whole megawatt of electricity or more to run all of these miners. And we blow a lot of air through it in the countryside, in the mountains, and
so your next one is, for security reasons, is your next one in this country or is it in another country?
No, I'm mining in Japan now.
Okay.
And the electricity there is very expensive compared to USA, where I was mining before.
How's it compared to Hawaii?
Well, Hawaii is insanely expensive. Yeah. It's like 36 cents a kilowatt hour here.
Yeah.
I mean, if you have the best miners and you have a very efficient setup, you could probably still do very, very well in Hawaii. But if you're starting out, you'd probably want to do it somewhere, you know, in the Nevada desert, you know.
Yeah, where they've got solar and they got ways to get, I mean, I was talking to some of our legislators just last week, and they were saying they want to get involved in this, be able to enable this kind of thing to happen. And I like the look on your face right now. And I went, and they said, and actually, I was talking to the governor. And he said, why can this not happen? I said, two reasons. One is cost of electricity. And second is, our education system sucks, and we're not educating people enough on.
Well, I was just
and
thinking,
I went that face to face with the governor, and I said that.
I was thinking HECO doesn't pay as much for their power as we pay for ours, so maybe they could get in the money.
Yeah, do you think they? Right.
Think the PUC would allow that?
Hey, they just PUC just gave them allowed them to do an increase on us after doing all this solar stuff. Yeah. Anyway, we digress. So come back to this. So now you're building or have built.
We're building it now.
Building it now.
And we're probably going to start mining with our first farm in Japan in the next few months. And it's a 1 megawatt facility.
Okay.
And we just got the latest ASICs, and it's going to be awesome.
So how many transactions can you say with a megawatt per hour? What do you project?
So the way mining works is you're trying to solve the next block in the Bitcoin blockchain.
Okay.
And even with a huge 1 megawatt facility, I mean, it's huge for us. We are only going to be able to solve a block maybe once every 8 or 10 days.
After this thing
is turned on.
And you're going to get a small percentage of that, which will create another transaction that needs to be authenticated.
Every block you solve in Bitcoin right now is 12 and a half Bitcoins for the block reward and maybe 1 or 2 Bitcoins for the transaction fees for all the transactions you include in that block.
So you're looking at, let's say for the sake of argument, 14 Bitcoins.
Around
so 14
there,
when you solve every time
solve
you
a block.
Solve one. And I'm going to sit here and do the math here while
if you solve 14 every 10 days,
15,000, you know, 15,000 times 14 equals...
What's the payback?
Matt, did I just read that right?
Yeah, if you solve one block in the Bitcoin blockchain, it's about $250,000 right now.
Yeah, $210,000.
So sure. what's your, how does it work? What are you looking at, 5 years?
Every 10 days, $210,000?
Well, that's the thing, right? In the whole world, all the miners are trying to compete, and they're coming out with new chips. And the Bitcoin network readjusts the difficulty to make it harder to mine Bitcoin.
Oh.
So as, over time, the mining farm will mine less and less Bitcoin.
Right.
And so it's very competitive.
Wow.
It's all about.
So you got to keep rolling out new versions of farms every.
Yeah, and it all comes down to how much electricity you have, you know, how much space you have. After a year or two, you might want to rip out your old gear and put in the newest gear and, you know.
What about the software behind doing the Bitcoin mining? I mean, can you improve that to make it more efficient? Not from a consumption standpoint, but from a speed standpoint on how that's been coded, because you've been coding for decades.
Well, everyone uses mining pools, and we run our own private mining pool. But the mining software and the mining pool software, it's all pretty much the same. Okay. It comes down to raw computational power.
Okay, so let me ask you this question. So I don't have the money to build a farm and do all this kind of stuff. Is there a way that someone can invest into someone like yourself who is building these farms, and then you're like a startup? So it's like I think it's Shark Tank or something like that, where I'm going to put some money into this, and then you're going to not guarantee me, but you know, say essentially you could possibly get this return.
Yeah, for sure. We structure the new business is we're kind of like a vendor. And if you have space and power and the logistics to do it, we will essentially build a farm for you. And we just take a percentage of the earnings.
Oh, wow. Oh, my house on the Big Island.
That's not a bad deal.
Which is freaking cold all the time.
It ain't that cold. This is a lot of heat.
There's a lot of heat.
I might turn your place into a mall cabin.
I could put it in the garage, man. It's just like the garage is always in the 60s.
I don't think it's big enough.
I mean, you usually want to do at least 1 megawatt. To start.
Yeah,
so,
well,
I don't know how much power you got there.
Helco, thanks a lot. I'd be really happy with what I'm
saying.
Suck
up all
there.
Of the Waimea. Waimea.
Waimea would have no power forever.
Yeah, so in Hawaii it's kind of tough, but there are many places in the world where it just makes
sense. So, legislators, can I just insert my little comment? Hawaii is kind of tough. Once again, you shut down Coinbase here. You know, shut down Coinbase. You make it real difficult for me to start up my ATM for Bitcoin purchasing. And now you got an electricity bill that's, you know, off the scale, and you said, oh, we want to bring Amazon here, or we want to bring so-and-so here.
I just don't think we're going to compete. But what's the future look like? I mean, so where's this going? I mean, you're in the business of installing 1 megawatt farms, or as big as they'll let you, you know, whatever they can.
Using Bitcoin to pay for it.
But I mean, yeah.
I mean, the future of Bitcoin, it's the new global financial system.
Yeah.
You know, we're talking about disrupting banks and government, and this is going to change the world more than the internet has, right?
I mean, seems to be as quickly as anything I've ever seen.
In our lifetime, you know, the internet has only had a few apps that really took on, and they're mostly just communication or sharing some data. This is money. This is the internet of money, and it's going to disrupt everything. Yeah. It's going to change the world. It's the biggest transfer of wealth in our lifetime.
That's true. So think about it. The biggest transfer of wealth in our lifetime, and governments think they're going to shut it down.
Yeah, how many, I mean...
You know what, I can ignore the government when it comes to
this. What's the market cap for to just offhand
200, on Bitcoin today is $260
billion
today.
$260 billion
today.
So what was it 4 years ago? 3 years? What was it last year?
It was like...
Half of that last year?
Way less.
So, I mean...
And we haven't started using it to buy things yet, which we can, though. A lot of us are holding it.
Right. Right now, Bitcoin is really good at a store of value.
Yes.
And next, you're going to see the layer two payment networks coming online. This is the Lightning Network and all these payment channel things where it's going to be almost free to do transactions. And then not only will Bitcoin have the store of value really solid, but also have the medium of exchange function of money.
So here's the dilemma we have, and we're going to watch it unfold over the next number of years. I'm sitting on a US dollar that's worth so much, but it doesn't fluctuate in value like Bitcoin does.
Sure.
So I can go buy my Starbucks with it and so on. I'm sitting on a Bitcoin right now that can go from $20,000 like it was 7 days ago to $13,000, which it was 7 days later. So do I sit, hold on it, whatever? So I'm not using it to buy anything yet. At what point do you think people start using it to buy things?
Well, we used Bitcoin for years to buy a coffee at the cafe and whatnot.
But that's true. You gave me my first Bitcoin to buy Starbucks. I don't even want to think of what I paid for that Starbucks.
Yeah, it was an expensive.
In today's terms, yeah. But he's in the mine from the mining perspective. I love it how they're making new Bitcoin. They're creating new Bitcoin by solving
right because blockchain. So, until Bitcoin reaches a certain critical mass of mainstream adoption, the network collectively, you know, rewards the miners for providing that security for running these big data centers of miners. And at a certain point, the block reward will get smaller and smaller,
I see.
And the transaction fees will get bigger and bigger. And at that point, The miners will be just be purely compensated on transaction fees alone.
I see.
So but right. that should not come close to the transaction fee on a credit card.
But I'm saying, but it's still speculative now to be building mining facilities, right? Because you're betting on going to more coin.
I think it's going to make you're going to be able to mine Bitcoin for years and years.
Oh, so you're talking about maybe a decade or more? Like, because it's going to be a while before it comes down to.
I mean, when Bitcoin is $100,000 or one Bitcoin is $1 million, you know, when more and more people join the system, even if you can only mine a tiny fraction of a Bitcoin, it's going to be worth so much.
And there's a finite number, 21 million, when the final number is, we're at 16 million and change.
21 million is going to be the cap on
the max. So we can't print more coins. We can't print more money.
Did they print coins?
Actually, there was a guy selling them, and they were actually.
I saw a guy in New York was selling the Chuck E. Cheese.
Chuck E. Cheese's coins are big.
What an ass!
People bought them. Oh. So okay, we got not too much time left. So what's your commentary on the future of where this thing is going and what's happening?
I mean, simply put, Bitcoin is the future of money. You know, you're talking total crypto anarchism, where banks are going to be printing money like crazy, but because of the fixed supply of Bitcoin, it's going to gain value very rapidly. You're going to see a hyperinflation of fiat currencies. You know, one Bitcoin is going to be worth millions of dollars because of the fixed supply. I mean, how many people do you know who own one ton of gold? You know?
Yeah. True. No,
Fort Knox, I don't know if they have a ton. That's a lot.
I mean, that's if you do the math, there's only 21 million Bitcoins. How many people are in the world, right?
That's right. And there's only 5 million in Bitcoin right now.
About 17 million have been mined already.
Okay.
And quite a number of them have been lost.
No, but individual people that are invested. It's only like it's 5 million people who have invested in Bitcoin.
Right. Hardly any people are using it.
Oh, I see.
So this is really the biggest transfer of wealth in our lifetime. And it's going to replace banks and fiat currency. You know, it'll be like the internet. Maybe it takes 20, 30 years to reach mainstream adoption where everyone has Bitcoin in their pocket. It's coming.
It's pretty cool.
That's so awesome.
Anyway, we burned through 28 minutes. So, JD, we're gonna we'll Skype you in for an update. We gotta bring you in when you go back to Japan. We'll Skype
you
in.
I'll come back for you, Gordo.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you.
He's a millionaire sitting on all his Bitcoin. Mind you, he lost his. But there is another story.
Let's not go there.
This is not for the faint of heart. We've told everybody we're not giving investment advice. Cryptocurrencies are not for the faint of heart.
Volatile.
It's very volatile. You got to believe in what's happening in the future. Anyway, we have somewhere around here a autographed solo cup. I'm not quite finished yet. Number 145 in the series. So don't lose this puppy. It could be worth, well, it's only 145.
0.00000
Bitcoin could be millions at one day.
There's going to be a lot of zeros in there.
A lot in there. Anyway, thank you for coming all the way from Japan, celebrating Christmas with us. You head back shortly. And keep us posted on what's going on. We didn't give you a heads up on this, on what we do at the end of every show, but we'll do it, and you can just look into the camera and look smart like you always do. So like we say at the end of every show, when you enjoy the show, when Hibachi talks, the people listen. 1, 2, 3. How you doing?
Thank you. That's awesome.
I could spend another two hours on this.
Good job.